You want to support Roller March Unfiltered? Be sure to join our Bring the Funk fan club. Every dollar that you give to us supports our daily digital show. There's only one daily digital show out here that keeps it black and keep it real. It's Roland Martin Unfiltered. Support the Roland Martin Unfiltered daily digital show by going to RolandMartinUnfiltered.com. You can make this possible. House Democrats introduced two articles of impeachment today against Donald Trump alleging abuse of power and obstruction of Congress regarding his interactions with Ukraine. Here is today's announcement.
Over the last several months, the investigative committees of the House have been engaged in an impeachment inquiry into President Donald Trump's efforts to solicit foreign interference in the 2020 elections, efforts that compromised our national security and threatened the integrity of our elections. Throughout this inquiry, he has attempted to conceal the evidence from Congress and from the American people. Our president holds the ultimate public trust. When he betrays that trust and puts himself before country, he endangers the Constitution, he endangers our democracy, and he endangers our national security. The framers of the Constitution prescribed a clear remedy for presidents who so violate their oath of office. That is the power of impeachment. Today, in service to our duty to the Constitution and to our country, the House Committee on the Judiciary is introducing two articles of impeachment charging the President of the United States, Donald J. Trump, with committing high crimes and misdemeanors. The first article is for abuse of power. It is an impeachable offense for the President to exercise the powers of his public office to obtain an improper personal benefit while ignoring or injuring the national interest. That is exactly what President Trump did when he solicited and pressured Ukraine to interfere in our 2020 presidential election, thus damaging our national security, undermining the integrity of the next election, and violating his oath to the American people. These actions, moreover, are consistent with President Trump's previous invitations of foreign interference in our 2016 presidential election. And when he was caught, when the House investigated and opened an impeachment inquiry, President Trump engaged in unprecedented, categorical, and indiscriminate defiance of the impeachment inquiry. This gives rise to the second article of impeachment for obstruction of Congress. Here, too, we see a familiar pattern in President Trump's misconduct. A president who declares himself above accountability, above the American people, and above Congress's power of impeachment, which is meant to protect against threats to our democratic institutions, is a president who sees himself as above the law. We must be clear, no one, not even the president, is above the law.
Now some would argue, why don't you just wait? Why don't you just wait until you get these witnesses the White House refuses to produce? Why don't you just wait until you get the documents the White House refuses to turn over? And people should understand what that argument really means. It has taken us 8 months to get a lower court ruling that Don McGahn has no absolute right to defy Congress. 8 months for one court decision. If it takes us another 8 months to get a second court or maybe a Supreme Court decision, people need to understand that is not the end of the process. It comes back to us and we ask questions because he no longer has absolute immunity, and then he claims something else, that his answers are privileged and we have to go to back to court for another 8 or 16 months. The argument, why don't you just wait, amounts to this. Why don't you just let him cheat in one more election? Why not let him cheat just one more time? Why not let him have foreign help just one more time? That is what that argument amounts to. The president's misconduct goes to the heart of whether we can conduct a free and fair election in 2020. It is bad enough for a candidate to invite foreign interference in our political process, but it is far more corrosive for a president to do so and to abuse his power to make it so. Despite everything we have uncovered, the president's misconduct continues to this day, unapologetically and right now. As we saw when he stood on the White House lawn and he was asked, what did you want in that July 25th call? And he said the answer was a simple one. And not just a simple one on July 25th, but a simple one today, and that is he still wants Ukraine to interfere in our election to help his campaign.
Joining us right now, Mustafa Santiago Ali, former senior advisor for the Environmental Justice, EPA. Also, Kelly Bethea, communication strategist, and Malik Abdul, Republican strategist. Mustafa, I'll start with you. Here's a president who has consistently lied to the American people. Some 14,000 lies that he has told. He lies about lies. He has lied about the transcript. He said, read the transcript. But they actually didn't release the actual transcript. Even in what was released, you hear him trying to hear them investigate Biden. But I would say the biggest thing is this is a man who refuses to be held accountable. Mm-hmm. He believes that he can do whatever he wants to do. He has said anybody has immunity. Even Corey Lewandowski, who has never even worked for the White House. I don't know how you can exert a privilege for somebody who's never even worked for your administration. He has refused to comply any subpoenas with Congress on any issue, not just Ukraine, not just Russia, but not just when it comes to taxes, on anything. What he has basically said is, y'all have absolutely no right to question me whatsoever. Democrats have no choice but to hold this man accountable.
Yeah, it's a gangster mentality. It's a privilege mentality. It's all those things wrapped up where, you know, and that's the reason they're hitting him now with obstruction of Congress and the abuse of power. And you know what's amazing, Roland, is that I spent 24 years in federal service. I engage with folks in and outside of our country. And if myself or anyone else had participated in this type of behavior, we would have been fired. You know, when we ran the grant programs and the contracts, and if I reached over to somebody who was expecting to get paid for something and said, you know what, I need you to do me a favor, I would have been fired. And these are the types of things that folks need to really be focusing on, because if you were an everyday person, this would not be acceptable. So you are the leader of our country. There's no way that this should ever be acceptable.
Kelly, he has said repeatedly, I can do what I want to do. Donald Trump does not believe that the Congress, that they should oversee anything that he does.
Yeah, so I think I touched on this a little bit last week, in that in order for our government to work, all three branches of government actually have to respect each other. And right now, the executive branch is just not respecting the other two branches of government, which is why it's a mess. The reason why these articles of impeachment were administered as opposed to the other things that we've been hearing for the past, what, 2-3 months, quid pro quo, obstruction, things of that nature. I think it was more along the line, the reasoning was more along the lines of what can we prove now without, you know, further interference from the White House, a branch of government that is not respecting the legislation. I also want people to remember that this is an indictment. We still have another step to go regarding the Senate. And that's when, honestly, the determining factor as to whether he's actually going to be removed from office is going to be coming from the Senate. So impeachment articles, great, great first step. But I'm anticipating some more hurdles down the line, especially when it comes on the Senate side.
Malik, how can the Trump administration call this process unconstitutional when it's literally written in the Constitution? Second question, how can you completely ignore Congress on any issue to say, we will ignore any subpoena, I will extend executive privilege to cover anybody, including folks who have never even worked for the government. And so therefore, Congress, you have absolutely no right. The law even says that, the law says that if Congress requests the taxes, the tax returns of any American, the IRS turn them over. Trump says, not me, I'm above the law. So at what point does he get the message that he is not above the law?
Well, I don't think that, you know, Trump can say, and his, you know, we all can say, people who support him, we can say whatever we want about what the Constitution allows. This is a constitutional process. It shouldn't be any surprise that a president is critical of a process that's critical or investigating him. I think that...
No, but he says it's totally unconstitutional.
Well, of course, Trump is going to say things like that.
So he's lying.
Well, Trump is going to say things like that, and he will
always
say
things like that. No, no, I'm asking you. Is he... When Donald Trump says...
It's not... From everything that I've read, that there is nothing unconstitutional about this process.
Right, because it's constitutional. I mean, the Constitution allows for it lays out a process where a president can be impeached, and if impeached, it goes for trial in the Senate. I mean, it's right there in the document.
Yeah, it does. But your question, you know, you had raised the point about whether or not this is something that, you know, how can a president just totally ignore, you know, congressional subpoenas and things like that. I think we probably saw in the case with Barack Obama, the Fast and Furious case, where his administration refused to turn over documents.
Actually, that's not what I said.
But that's.
But actually, that's not what I said. You said, what I said was, how can a president
refuse to comply with the congressional subpoena?
No, with any subpoena.
Okay.
On any topic, on any request.
Well, I don't know what you're using to gauge that on any request.
Well, I'm sorry. But if
the audience would like to know whether or not this is something that administrations have done in the past, then we would have to say yes.
Show me where the Obama administration
refused to turn over documents regarding the Fast and Furious case.
One second. Show me where the Obama administration, on multiple investigations.
Well, I don't have those multiple instances, but I have one that federal judge
actually... That's what I said, though. So if you're going to say what I said, that's what I said.
Well, it's important to talk about what the federal judge actually ruled as far as the Obama administration, where it forced the administration to turn over those Fast and Furious documents.
Did they?
Yes, they did.
Here's my question.
Does the law state
that if Congress requests the tax records of any American, they must be turned over?
I think the law does say that.
And Trump has said, I'm above the law, I'm not turning them over.
But I don't know. Did a court rule on whether or not he was supposed to turn over?
No, I'm sorry, but there's a law already. So why do you need a court to rule if there's already a law?
Well, because it's the same reason that we're actually, the conversation about John Bolton. Remember, people are, you know, pulling their hair out saying that John Bolton actually refused to testify. What John Bolton said, what he asked was, he asked a federal judge to issue a ruling on whether or not he could testify, and that's where we are now.
So what they're trying to do is say, fine, a federal judge must tell us we must... So basically what they're saying is, we want a federal judge to tell us we must comply with the law.
Well, isn't that what they have the right to do? I think that's actually what...
Even though the law is already the law.
If you remember what Jonathan Turley was referring to last week, and he was talking about the process, the White House, you know, they have every right to go to the court to get clarification on this issue of executive privilege.
So you're saying that in a case of executive privilege, how can the White House assert executive privilege for somebody who's never even worked for the White House?
Well, the federal judge who issued the ruling on McGahn, No.
McGahn was a White House counsel.
Right.
And I'm talking about Corey Lewandowski, who has never worked for the White House. How can Donald Trump assert that I can extend privilege to anybody?
Well, I don't know.
What he's literally saying is that if Melick if you get called before Congress, and about a conversation you had with Trump, Trump is saying, no, executive privilege.
Well, Corey Lewandowski wasn't connected to this case, so
no,
I
no,
don't...
No, 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 no. Corey Lewandowski, when he went before Congress, Donald Trump sent White House lawyers who sat behind him, tell me if I'm wrong, Mustafa.
You're right.
Sat behind him and said he cannot answer any questions about any conversation with Donald Trump because Donald Trump has asserted executive privilege. How do you assert executive privilege for somebody who's never worked for you?
So you're saying that Corey Lewandowski actually showed up for the hearing?
When Corey Lewandowski showed up, Corey Lewandowski said, oh, I can't talk about that because the White House is asserting executive privilege.
Well, that still seems like something that a court should actually decide, which is
the point. How does a court decide that, this applies when he's never worked for the White House?
Okay, but my point still about when I was mentioning Don McGahn, that what the court ruled is that the Trump administration does not have blanket immunity.
No. But it's my whole point. You going to court mm-hmm. for a guy who worked for you is one thing. But to assert executive privilege, Mustafa,
they didn't
somebody
go to court
who
on
never
Corley
even worked for you shows you how thuggish they are when mm-hmm. in terms of we don't have to answer jack. Right. We will do what we want to do.
Right. This is unprecedented. I mean, in the five presidents that I worked for before, no one ever tried anything like this. And that's the reason that they're finding themselves in the situation that they are. Now, the point is that the folks in the Senate have to actually do the right thing. And we, the people, have to get engaged in this process. I'm still amazed that we have marches for everything. We have marches for the environment, which is important. We have marches for gun violence, which is important. We've got to have people out here actually marching for our democracy. And there should be millions of people in the street when this moves to the Senate to say that we are going to hold you accountable if you do not do the right thing. And that's how we hold them accountable in the White House for this rogue administration. And I don't throw that word around loosely. Based upon the actions that they've been moving forward on and how they have been approaching the law, they have no respect for the law.
Right.
They'll try and utilize the law.
Kelly, that's the real deal here. They don't have respect for the law.
No.
To sit here in the middle of this whole deal, and it is undeniable that they wanted Ukraine and held up this relief, this money to Ukraine, to investigate the Bidens, and to have Trump's thuggish lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, mm-hmm. still going to Ukraine.
He's there now, isn't he?
I mean, bottom line is, they don't care. And the reality is, the founders set this up specifically for a person like Trump.
Mm-hmm.
For somebody who ignores and flouts the law to say the only way to hold him accountable is the impeachment process.
But what's funny to me with this entire situation is even coming out of Trump's camp, no one's denying what actually happened. No one in his camp is saying that phone call didn't exist. No one in his camp is saying any of those things. They're just like, so what?
Right.
So what? So, and to Melick's point regarding the Obama administration and Fast and Furious, even with that whole debacle, the Obama administration still abided by the law. Yes, they exercised their right to go to a court. Keep in mind, Obama was a constitutional lawyer before he became president. He's a constitutional law professor. Like, his entire career outside of community organizing was, you know, rooted in constitutional law. So he knew what he was doing. And there was a question regarding whether that was constitutional, that he had to overturn it. Whether that ruling was, you know, good or not is debatable, but the fact of the matter is, he still listened to the court, and after the court gave their ruling, he did what the court said to do. Right. So, again, back to my earlier point of three branches of government respecting each other in order for this democracy to work, the Obama administration did that, regardless of whether, you know, you feel like he made mistakes in his administration. He still abided by the law, and he upheld the Constitution thoroughly through all 8 years of his presidency.
Well, what Obama did, and Obama did, his administration did turn over those documents, but he did that, I think it was probably about after 3 years, which is when the federal judge made the ruling, forcing them to turn over the documents. So yes, the Obama administration did turn over those documents years after Congress had subpoenaed them.
Because that's how long it took for a ruling to come
down. Which connects to my point that I'm making, that the Trump administration, they had every right.
But the court said, hand over the documents.
So I ask this question real simple.
Melanie,
this is real simple. Did Donald Trump ask Ukraine to investigate Joe Biden?
It sounds like he did. And there was nothing perfect about the call that Donald Trump
had. And was that wrong?
Yeah.
And why were Republicans, though, unwilling to own up to that? Why do they act like it's no big deal? Is it wrong for a president to ask a foreign entity for help in investigating a political rival.
Yes, it is. The question is whether or not that's something that should be impeachable.
Well, first of all, the Constitution defines that Congress, the House,
that a misdemeanor or
high crimes or misdemeanors.
It could be anything that they actually say that it is.
Right. But you admit what he did was wrong.
Well, I've always said that the president shouldn't have actually made that ask.
Right. But many Republicans don't even want to own up to that being a fact.
Well, we know how politics works. So whether it's Donald Trump or any other president, the question before the American people is whether or not we're moving towards this in the Senate. My answer is I'm pretty sure that that's not going to happen. But as we're seeing with the polls in all of the battleground states, that the fervor, the interest, the support for impeachment is actually declining in those battleground states.
Here's the piece. At last time I checked, when I read the Constitution, it says nothing about battleground states. Right. What it says is
impeachment is a political process.
What it says is that how do you hold the president accountable? Mm-hmm. And I dare say this here. If you are a Democrat or Republican, what you should not do is say, I'm going to take an action based upon what a poll says. What I'm going to do... What I'm going to say is I'm going to take an action based upon what is right, what is fair, and is just. And because each person, when they are sworn in, they put their hand on the Bible or whatever they want to put their hand on to say, I swear to uphold and protect the Constitution from enemies foreign and domestic. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the reality is, if you are an individual, whether you are a federal judge, whether you're a House member, a Senate member, or the President of the United States, if you are doing things that go against the Constitution of this United States, then there are going to be repercussions.
Yeah,
and that is the case here, and that's where it should be. And there should be Republicans who are looking at this from a country standpoint, not a party standpoint.
Well, we do
Final
know,
comment before I go yeah, to this
well,
Stephen
we do
Mill
know
story.
That this is a total political process. And so what Democrats probably should have done, and I said this before, is that they probably should have moved towards censure, and they probably could have had more Republicans and even those Democrats who are there's questionable whether or not you're going to have those Democrats come on to support it. I honestly think that, yes, they're absolutely going to impeach the president in the House. That has been the plan since day one, before he even took office, of making him a one-term president. And so as far as the party, the Democratic Party, and catering to that base who wants Trump to be kicked out of office, I think that they've got up. This is a slam dunk for them.
Mustafa, go ahead.
I was just going to say, let's remember when President Obama came in and leadership on the Senate side said we're going to do everything we can to stop him and to make sure that he is a
on the night of his inauguration.
President.
Yeah. That wasn't on the night of his inauguration.
Actually, it was.
No, it wasn't. We've been through this on your show before. We've been through this on your show before, Roland, and that's just factually incorrect.
So we wasn't next day?
That was. I think that probably was referring to, was it nope, September? It was the fall of that
no,
year.
Actually, no.
It just wasn't, Roland.
Kelly, your final comment.
I want people to disabuse the notion that we need to keep referring to Obama during a Trump era.
But you have to.
No, you don't.
Actually, you don't.
Kelly,
here's your point. Go ahead.
First of all, you kind of can't compare Trump to the Obama administration because Trump hasn't done anything remotely parallel.
But they're still presidents, though.
Actually, if
you want to compare Trump to anybody, you compare him to Nixon. Mm. You compare him to Clinton. You compare him to Andrew Johnson. And that is the three other presidents where you had either a formal impeachment process or an impeachment inquiry. That's the deal. But you cannot compare to Obama because Obama wasn't impeached, did nothing even close to getting impeached. But the reality is...
But he obstructed Congress.
But this president... Okay. It's nonsense. Finish your
facts don't lie.
Point. Finish your point, Kelly.
Facts don't lie.
Kelly, finish your point.
Trump is not Obama. We are not in the era of Obama anymore, unfortunately. We're not even in an era of Obama that we actually will be proud of at the end of the day. We are in a Trump era, and... Like you said, we can't compare him to Obama because Obama never did anything to this level that rose to the level of impeachment. Trump has. Obama didn't obstruct Congress. Trump did.
Yes,
Obama
sir.
Didn't go over to Ukraine.
That's what it said.
No.
Go ahead and finish.
No.
Go ahead and finish.
Obama didn't do any of the things that Republicans are denying that Trump actually did. So we can't draw those parallels because they don't exist.
All right, folks, back to that Roadmark Unfiltered video in just one moment. All right, folks, it's the holiday season. This is when you think about spending time with your family and friends. This is also when you count your blessings and support those less fortunate. This year, you can become a holiday hero and change someone's life forever. Right now, hundreds of thousands of people are sitting in jail without being convicted of a crime. Why? Because they can't pay their bail. If you're arrested for any minor offense, you'll be taken directly to jail. If you don't have bail money, you will sit there until a court date is scheduled. That could be days, weeks, or even months. Simply put, America's bail system is broken for people of color. Freedom should not be free. So the Ebony Foundation is partnering with the Bail Project. They're sponsoring Home by the Holiday campaign. The goal is to get 1,000 people bailed out of jail by the end of the year. A donation from you can change someone's life tomorrow. So what they want you to do is simply go to Home. Well, first of all, you can donate $25, $50 or more to the Ebony Foundation. So go to homebytheholiday.com. It's homebytheholiday.com for you to help somebody get out of jail and be with their loved ones for this Christmas season. Now back to your Roland Martin Unfiltered video.